John Smallwood and Edward Bao, live from Red Bank, New Jersey. We are continuing today the conversation on navigating financial pressure, nine core principles. Welcome, Ed.
How's everybody today?
So far, I'm pretty good. Seems like the weekends and the weekdays are the same. There's no difference. A lot of conversations seem to be the same.
I've been talking to people and they're telling me about how they are trying to find things to do at home because they're not really working right now from home for whatever, those jobs that are. And I don't know about you, but I've been busier than I've ever been personally and professionally. I'm kind of glad we're kind of locked down. I can't go anywhere.
The craziest time ever, actually. The craziest time ever. It's funny though, like the joke out there is I've consumed Netflix. I've watched Netflix. Now what? Right?
Need a new streaming service.
Need a new streaming service, which you don't need. But so what I wanted to do today, we kind of ended up last time with talking about the financial pressure. And you and I were having a conversation earlier today about the learning the rules again. That as things are good, you seem to forget.
Well, you know, these core principles are really, they're really ingrained in both John and I. There's certain things in how we look at things, and it's really based on economics and when you make a decision, why, you know, how is it going to help my plan? I fall back to, in my own way, is that people tend to make decisions and they kind of paint themselves into a corner. And everything that John and I talk about is the opposite, right? You know,
they're making a decision right now and not looking out at the future.
Right. So it's that pebble in the pond and the ripple effects that pebble being the decision makes. And, you know, you're always pushed up against the markets because, you know, they play such a big role in some respects in all our plans, right?
Accumulation, yeah.
Accumulation.
Grow, grow, grow.
Even a decumulation. If I'm taking withdrawal and I'm in that, I call it the default strategy where I'm just my only, you know, besides maybe Social Security, I'm pulling income from my accounts. You know, the markets are playing a really big role. And with the markets really, they were on, you know, we've had a pretty good run since 2009. And this is the other part to this that, and I'm saying this and I know it, that 2018, the last quarter of 2018, we had a negative 20%.
In about a month and a half.
Yeah. By December 20th.
Christmas Eve massacre.
Yeah, there you go. and it like, it never even happened.
Because by February.
By February, it just got wiped away and shooed away, and nobody felt the pain from that. And so even though I said we had this great run, and we actually had, well, technically I would call it a bear market there because we were down 20%, it never happened. And then this happened in March. Well, started in late February and went into March. But and the severity and the ferocity of this can really unhinge you. Like, and then it really brought me back to the core principles of say, when you have the right structure and you know, we did a webinar today on basically guaranteed income. Yeah. Why is that so important? And it plays a role in the plan.
I think it's that confidence factor.
Yeah.
In getting there. I want to back up for a second. With the nine core principles, I want to run through them real quick again, because the way we look at this is that the dynamics of every single one of these components has multiple possible, let's say, modifications and or changes. And you, inside of each one, you change one of those variables slightly, you get a different outcome. Inside of each pressure, there's multiple variables. But you think about the nine variables, if you change, you have an assumption of variables making up your plan, and you change slightly change each variable slightly, the plan's not even the same plan, right?
So it's like having a conversation with a different person on the phone.
Technically, it is. So number one, we talk about family and everything that goes on in your family. And right now, your family, the changes are tremendous. I mean, jobs, you know, leases and businesses having issues and cash flow problems. Who knows what your family is going through?
Well, that you have potentially kids who we got off the payroll and launched them or kind of back at home because maybe they have an apartment in New York City and they don't really want to be there. They're back at home and, you know.
Living with their family members.
Right.
So then you had these things that, you know, the second pressure is future outflows, inflows. Like you thought you were going to educate your child one way and now things are different and you're hearing that college costs might change or, hey, if the school is going to be online for this semester, maybe you don't want to send the kid back to a, you know, a $70,000 a year school for an online experience. Maybe you want to go to the local community college, establish some credits and go back. And the big schools are scared out of this, out of their minds over this. Because once they leave, chances of coming back are slim.
I have, you know, as John knows, I have somebody, my middle guy is in school and you know, you're paying a tuition for an experience.
And it's not just the education.
Right. They're there to get educated, but it's in a certain setting. And why do we go look at all these different colleges? Because
you're looking for that feeling.
That good feel. Right. Exactly what I was saying. That feel, right? And it's the right fit for the child. And, you know, but now, okay, so they're 3 years into it. Now they have to do virtual. Well, is that really worth the
experience?
You know, that amount of money? I mean, does what you know, these online universities that are much less expensive, you know, I'm in the same boat with them now. That's what they're scared of, right? They're, you know.
Right. So you're looking at your family dynamic. Your family dynamics are going to change. And that's going to impact you. Now you have these future outflows that you were gearing up to spend, and now that you're questioning them. But in the same vein, we talk about future inflows. Future inflows might be business income coming in, transactions, sales of businesses, potentially inheritances, tax refunds, all kinds of crazy stuff that you might have been expecting that now, due to outside influences, which has always been the case, are going to impact that. Mm-hmm. And the plan is off target because every single one of those variables has changed. Now, like I look at my world, I have two kids out, one kid in college, and one kid that's 2 to 3 years out from going to college. And then there's weddings that might come sooner or later. And then there's, you know, private high school and, you know, sweet 16s and car insurance and
grandkids.
And that pressure becomes, oh, God forbid, I'm just kidding. But in the moment, that financial, the family dynamics, and then that inflow, outflow that you've said that you wanted to do as part of your overall plan is really impacting, or maybe making a kitchen improvement, or, you know, anything that you guys are thinking about. All of these things need to be rethought mm-hmm. and refocused on, right? So we start looking at that. Number three pressure is income sources. Like,
well, the funny thing, when you were talking about inflows and being disrupted just now, I'm thinking to myself, well, aren't we talking about income too? Like, you know, if the 2 months, maybe I'm on track for X, and now because I'm in maybe a commission type business, I'm now going to get Y because basically I was put on the shelf for 2 months. Yeah. You know, that changes a lot.
I was having a conversation with somebody the other day. They were up 20% in their sales forecast through like March 10th, close business.
Nice.
The entire April and May has taken out their entire year. Now they're in no bonus world.
Wow.
So when you start thinking about the way these bonus structures work, sometimes that could be half or more of your, or sometimes 80% of your compensation structure.
Right.
So all of a sudden you're in the middle of a good year, now you're in the middle of a bad year. And so the income sources. So we start talking about, it's the family, it's the outflow, inflow, it's the income sources. And what we're seeing now for the business owners, the conversations are either they're doing great or they're down 100% to 95% and everything in between there, whether you're a business owner or you're a corporate owner. And now we have a new verbiage of, you know, words such as PPP and PPE and, you know,
what's the
SBA loans and
which
CARES Act, the CARES Act, the Secure Act, you know, all these things that are impacting the income. And the big question is, a lot of people are taking the PPP with the intent of getting their income back on track, their businesses back on track. Mm-hmm. Now they're still 20, 30 days away from being able to flick that switch on their business. And they're scared to pay their people.
Yeah.
People are afraid to come back. So this financial pressure is, we want you to think through this from the standpoint of financial pressure is both positive and negative, right? We attract it and we get rid of it, right? It comes and goes. It's a yin and yang. And sometimes we have more financial pressure than other times. And this would be one of those times when you look at global markets, where the markets are globally is surprising with all the events that are going on worldwide. It's not just the pandemic. It's Hong Kong. It's an oil war. It's, you know, the riots that are going on around the United States as we record this. But this has always been true, right? So, but it's how do you navigate through it? And the key is by understanding these different dynamics, that's really what's important. The outside influences are here, but they're not, they're going to impact it, but how do I react to it? And reacting to it is not stick my head in the sand. How do I react to it is how do I, you know, look at these things, make a decision. Hey, if my kid's going to be online in the fall, tough, you're not going to do it online. We're going to sign up for something else. Mm. I got a tuition refund from my senior who graduated this year. I laughed. It was nice, but I laughed. It was less than $900.
I think you got me beat.
I laughed. I was like, that's really great. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. So, you know, what I just wanted to do, I'm going to hit these quick. You know, so number four is taxation. Number five is savings rate. Number six is the debt structure. Number seven is the asset balance. And number eight is the liquidity goals. And I have the wrong form in front of me. Number nine is the defense, okay? And so you start looking at all these dynamics, and what we want people to think about is when the world is good, we kind of forget this. And this is a conversation that we were having earlier. You kind of get, you know, it'll be fine. And you don't have to be as frugal. You don't have to be as diligent in pulling the belt tight.
So how many times did we hear in 08, I never want to go through that again?
Yeah.
Okay. So
that's a really good point.
And so you start doing, you know, and then we have an unprecedented run, basically. For 10 years, we'll call it. But this is the human behavior behind this, right? Think of something that you've done and you said, I will never do that again. And a month goes by and 6 months go by and a year goes by and you end up doing that same thing.
Groundhog Day.
Well, because you had to do it. Like I was just, I remember I had a broken nose, I had a deviated septum, and I got it fixed. I'm like, no big deal, fix it. And they shove the packing up your nose, and you sit there for days, and it feels like Chinese water torture is pouring out of your nose, and you're like, I will, and I'm pretty resilient when it comes to stuff. I'm like, I'll never do this again. This was just horrible.
Never break your nose again.
Right. Well, guess what? 6 months later, he wanted to do another procedure, which was similar. And I went and did it because I needed to get it done. And B, by that time, I didn't remember how bad it was.
You forget how bad it was.
Yeah. So we have, you know, the term, we have short memories. So the same thing is, you know, you were saying, oh, we were talking about how good it get, you know, and we kind of, you get complacent, right?
Right.
Not that we're always looking for the other shoe to drop or we're word pessimist by any means. I don't think I'm a pessimist by any
means. But there's like
imagination.
You have to think about it. And, you know, I listened to YouTube video that somebody posted from Jim Rohn, who's like an old motivational speaker. He's no longer here, but he was talking about life in the form of a seasons. The seasons come. We have no control over it. Winter comes, spring, summer, fall, right? And they come every single year. And it's, you know, if you can't survive winter, it doesn't matter where you're going to be in the spring because you didn't survive winter. So when do you get ready for winter? You can't get ready in winter. Like the squirrel can't go find his nuts and in the winter survive, right?
Okay.
So in the spring, you're getting ready to sow the seeds. You're nurturing them. You're investing. You're putting money aside, right? And the analogy continues on where, you know, in the summer, you got to get rid of the weeds. You got to get rid of the stuff that's trying to take away. Everybody's trying to steal your stuff, right? The rodents and the varmints and the insects and the weather.
All the
pressures coming at you. And then you finally get to the point where you can harvest and you need to layer the harvest so that the harvest can be done over a period of time. And once you harvest, then you got to take some of that harvest and stockpile it for the winter and for the future.
Right.
And it's just repeating pattern. But winter always comes. And this is a form of winter. And on the back end of winter is tremendous opportunity if you survive winter. And the key is what we're trying to get people to do is to set up so that we know winter is coming. We got to build a defense around that winter. So when winter does occur, because it's not a surprise, it's going to happen. And this is why the analogy just blew me away. I should probably find the link and post it, right? But it's an amazing analogy because, you know, light is followed by dark, right? You keep digging down into the minutiae of each of these conversations. This is an opportunity where winter came. And winter for some is going to be horrific. We have, you know, we all thought when this lockdown was going to be happening by Easter, we would be back to normal.
Yeah, that's right.
Right?
Yeah.
It's June 1st. All right. We're in the Northeast. We're not anywhere near normal.
No.
Okay. So my point is winter's a little bit longer than we thought it would be. And as that winter comes out, are we ready to take advantage of the opportunities that are here in front of us? The only way we can be ready is to kind of rethink the entire plan. And that's why this wealth curve conversation is, by having the right balance in the plan, you're prepared for winter. You're prepared to get your seeds out. You know, Leanne, who works for us, has worked for us, what, 14 years, 15 years?
Pretty long.
Pretty long time. Her father is a tomato farmer at one point in his life.
I thought you meant now.
Now it's a hobby. But he spends... From February, he starts nurturing the plants, getting them ready to bring outside, and then they got heat blankets on them. And it's an amazing, when you start thinking about how he gets these tomato plants out, and then when they come out, and when they start really producing, you know, ripe tomatoes, they come at such a frequency that it's hard to get rid of them.
And you know what? I'm just thinking.
It's like an abundance of it.
I guess, you know, he's putting so much love into these things. I can't believe he actually eats the damn thing, you know?
Wait, but it's just going to rot and go away if you don't harvest it and push it around. And you got to share it.
And he does share it.
And you got to share it, right? So this is the whole concept is that as we start here to think about this, when you're building the plan, you need to understand where your financial pressure is currently, where it might be in the future. Doesn't really matter where it's been in the past, but we don't want to end up where we are in the past. Like what you were talking about is, you know, getting back to this concept of the repeating pattern. I don't want to be in this position. I don't want to be, you know, retiring in this position. I don't want to go through this again. These are things we need to go through, But the better we're prepared for it when it occurs. Like I was having a conversation earlier with an advisor out in California who's a good friend of mine for a lot of years. And we were talking about structure in the plan of having, you know, cash and investments so that you have, when the markets do what they're doing, you have an opportunity to take some of your dry powder and put it to work. If you don't, you never have the opportunity. And it, those cycles, having cash back for a cycle, is what gives you the power to take advantage of the opportunities. If all your powder is wet, it's in, and the markets are down, you have nothing to take advantage of. And this, you know, for years, I have this conversation. I can't have the cash sitting around making nothing. I can't have my cash sitting around making 2, 3, 4%. I think that's a great thing because you have the availability of the liquidity. Now we're in this crisis. If I didn't have that cash and I got to take money in a down market to because I don't have enough income because my income is bad, I'm in a crappy spot.
Well, sure. And they forget the cash would dampen the effect, right, on the downside. And conversely, like you said, we're getting told, I can't be, you know, market's up 12% and they feel like they're missing something, right? It's
only made 2% of my money.
Only 2%. I could be making so much more. Yeah, but when you're down 30% in 4 weeks, does that feel good too?
And most people won't take any of that cash and add it to the down 30% when it is, because now they're afraid of the loss.
Right.
And that's the psychology of what I'm trying to get to, is right, that we don't want to go through it. We don't want to go through it. But when we're going through it, we don't look at it as an opportunity.
Right.
Okay. And it is an opportunity for many of us. Okay. But what's more important, you know, I don't want to take away from the negativity that's out there, death and things that are, I don't want to come off the wrong way on this.
Sure.
You know, I hope everybody's safe. I hope your families are safe. I hope your families are safe from the riots that are going on. I don't want to come off callous. But I'm talking about having a good plan requires things to be in different balances at different times, to be deployed at different times. I was having a conversation with somebody about a month ago about deploying his reserves that we had set aside for an opportunity just like this. And he said, my two businesses aren't producing any income. I can't do it mentally. I'm like, you can't. I won't let you do it.
Yeah, and so we're kind of, this is going back to the 9 core principles we're talking about. It's like, and kind of we're beating a dead horses, but understanding each one of those core principles and how they affect each other, because they do, they all relate to each other in some form or fashion.
Right.
And understanding that, and it seems like a pretty simple concept, but when we sit down with people, they fall off so quickly, like for whatever reason, whatever they're chasing, whatever they're doing, whatever they're thinking.
Because it's your nature to want the best. And we all believe that we should have the highest rate of returns and the cheapest amount of taxes. But it comes with work. And it doesn't come overnight.
No.
It doesn't come in one cycle. One
right.
Quarter,
if it was one season. If it was easy. Right. If it was easy, then everybody would have it and everybody doing it. But you know, and coordinating all that thought is the key to that too, right?
Like it's knowing the pressures that are in your plan. There are known pressures, right? There are known pressures that I know right now are in my plan. Have I accepted that they are pressures? Have I acknowledged them? Are they, yes, this is a pressure. I need to fix it. I have 19 streaming services. I'm just joking. But probably have more than I believe I have, right? Is my, you know, where's the pressure in my plan? What steps am I going to take to mitigate or reduce that financial pressure? If I don't take any steps towards it, I'm never going to get this change. It begins with understanding where you are. Like I could be talking about the greatest rate of return on something and it has this great investment. Everybody wants to, oh, I want to find more about that. Meanwhile, I'm bleeding on the other side. I'm totally hemorrhaging money. That's not appropriate. Right. And it's never going to work. And that's what I want to get people to think about is, how do you get through, how do you navigate through this pressure? How do you redesign your plan, rethink your plan in every single one of these components?
Right.
What steps are you taking right now to make your plan better so you won't go through this the same way? You'll go through it again, but you won't go through it the same way. That's the key.
I mean, well, and I'm thinking here, I'm sitting here going, okay, well, you need to organize your plan, right? I'm thinking of the things that we do on a daily basis, right? We organize it, and we look at it, we analyze it, and we have some real smart people as some of our clients, but they still don't see it the way we see it. Because
that's why they keep coming back, because they don't see it.
Right.
I'm an expert at what I do. I'm not an expert in this.
Right. This is what we see it every day. We've seen it multiple variations every day. And I always say, I need one thing from you when we sit down and we're going to work together. I need you to have an open mind, because unfortunately there have been blinders put up, like on the what is that, the handsome cab in Manhattan, so that the horse doesn't get straight.
Right.
And I don't know if it's marketing or just the noise that we get out there every day that pops these blinders on, because they think that's the only way it can be done. And you're like, no, you know, and then,
well, it's no different than like social, you know, searching something on the internet. And then those blinders, now every time you go on the internet, there's that thing that you've been looking at.
Yeah, right.
And the ads are being pushed at you. It's 100% focused towards something that probably is not appropriate. But it's that same, like, you need blinders of those pop-up ads that are coming at you because you did a search for, I need a Suzuki part, blah, 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 or whatever it is.
Looking at tires or something.
Tires, or I'm looking at, and all of a sudden it's like, oh.
They're going to make me buy those tires every minute of the day if I'm not, right, like, careful.
And it comes on every form of social media. And to me, it's like, a successful financial strategy begins with identifying where the financial pressures are.
Mm-hmm.
It begins with addressing those financial pressures. And those financial pressures are going to come from, you know, your family, the income, the taxes, the savings, the debt structures, the lifestyle, the way your assets are structured now, where they are. They might be illiquid assets. You might have a lot of assets on paper, but they're completely illiquid, right? You don't have the right liquidity, you don't have the right balance. You made all these obligations or promises to your family, and now you may not be able to fulfill them, or maybe you can fulfill them, okay? But they're gonna have a dire impact on your ability to retire. Like, this is, you know, and then that protection. How is the wealth protected? Every single one of these must be optimum today.
Yep.
And when shit changes, and the world gives us change, we got to go back and look at, how did it impact us, and what changes do I need to make? And that's really the conversation that needs to happen over and over and over and over again, over the accumulation phase of your wealth plan, over the distribution phase or like retirement phase. And then in the final hours before we distribute the wealth, is it appropriately going? Have I minimized the taxes? Have I, you know, and this is what you were saying earlier, and I want to stop and I want to go back to this, is that it's the blinders and it's making decisions in the moment, not understanding the consequences in the future.
Yeah.
When we look at the tax laws that we've had in the last 2.5 years and the changes that will be undone within the next, you know, what is it, 5 months to an election, right, from where we're sitting here? Yeah, it's 5 months, right? Or 4 years and 5 months, right? And all these things get unwound and changed. I need to be building a plan that I'm thinking about, you know, we're all mad about SALT deduction, state and local income taxes, right? That we're limited to $10,000. People are leaving the high tax states, going to the low tax states, right? And then mortgage interest and things like that. When the tax law sunsets in 2025 or 2026, all that stuff comes back. SALT is no longer a limited deduction. You want to be maximizing those deductions for today and tomorrow. If you're not thinking about tomorrow, now it might change, But it also may not change any way from the way it was before. We don't know, but I got to take the knowledge that I have and apply it to the plan and know that everything I'm about to talk about with you is going to change. The rules of the game are going to change. The outcomes are going to change.
Right, because the institutions, whichever one you want to talk about.
The product purveyors.
Right. The government. Right. They're gonna set the rules. You know, it's like, you know, we've been talking with the stimulus and the just the help that they've been giving, you know,
the Fed,
obviously the PPP loans, all that stuff. I mean, we're writing a lot of checks, meaning as a society, you know.
Somebody's got
to
pay for it.
Somebody's going to have to pay for it. There's just, you know, nobody argues this when you talk to them. Everybody knows this.
Right.
When is that day of reckoning?
The taxes are going to go up to pay for these programs.
Yeah.
On somebody.
And what the problem is who's the person that's going to do it when they get into office? Because they're not going to be popular
right.
when they do it.
And where do you draw the line in the sand?
Right.
And how do you... In what I, you know, what we always talk about for years and years and years, there's the headline of the change. And this goes back to way back in the early 90s when New Jersey raised its income tax rate from, I think it was like 3% to 5%.
Oof.
I think Governor Florio was in office.
Big percentage move there.
Right? But it was like, 3% to 5%. But what they also did at the same time is they took away deductions.
Double hit.
So they took away your deduction for the property tax. They took away a couple other things. So now if you made $100,000 but you had $15,000 of deductions, you'd pay tax on, you know, on $85,000 at 5% versus 3%, but now you're paying tax on $100,000 at 5%. That's a huge increase.
Yeah.
It was a doubling of the tax without actually doubling the tax. So it's a smoke in the mirrors that we need to be prepared for, and who's going to actually pay for this
right
at some point.
You know, I'm thinking, you know, back to if taxes are going up in the future, you know, is tax deferral, you know.
You have to question everything that you're doing.
I don't want to pay the tax now because I want to pay higher later.
You know? In a lot of cases, you're going to pay higher taxes later.
Right.
In a lot of cases... You know, but that's, again, looking at your timeline. You may not have saved enough money, and you might be in a very high tax bracket right now because you're making a lot of money, but the day that you retire, your income is going to go down by 2/3. You're going to be in a lower tax bracket. Unfortunately.
Depending.
Most likely. Right? But you're not happy about it.
Maybe.
You're not happy about it, right? Yeah. You want to be, you know...
You're not paying a lot of taxes, but you're not enjoying retirement like you wanted to. So, which pick your poison, right?
Yeah, I mean, we on that presentation that we were doing today, we were talking about the enjoyment. Like, it's the you work 30, 40 years to accumulate the wealth to enjoy it, and if you can't enjoy it because of fear of running out of money or because you're not protected properly. There's so many lightning bolts.
And your focus, you know, it's amazing because, I mean, I just had this conversation 45 minutes ago with a client. And I'm like, do you really want to be looking at this stuff when you're in retirement? Because all the stats that we heard again today, which we know, is, you know, when financial pressure's off, you're actually enjoying yourself more in your retirement. You actually live longer. Imagine that, right? That's probably not too surprising. But what do people do? Again, it's you got to love it. It's, they're focused in on it. They're spending hours a day managing their finances because they're fearful too, right?
Yeah.
You can't. Sometimes we try to. You got to get them out of their own way, and it's, you know, you have to. That's, you know. So the core principles again,
right,
is understanding the pressure, and then, listen, we're risk managers, not just from an investment perspective. We
from
look,
every part.
We look at all the pressures are the risks, right? So we look at it and go, okay.
The pressures are the risks. That is a wonderful way to say it.
Thank you.
Because the pressures are the risk.
Right.
And it's not the one pressure. It's hundreds of pressures.
How do we reduce the risk in your portfolio? It's how do we reduce the pressures?
And it's not just market risk. It's longevity risk. It's disability risk.
Credit risk.
Premature deaths. Credit risk. Hey, I have a great opportunity. I can't borrow any money. My credit's
worse. How about creditor risk?
That's creditor risk too. I mean, you can like, so you start thinking about, we got the 9 core principles of navigating financial pressure. We have 7 basic goals when we enter the financial planning strategy, right? Our number one goal is to reduce the taxes on the plan today and throughout the entire time frame of the plan.
Right.
Most people are accelerating taxes today and in the future, right? We want to do the opposite. We want to reduce risk, and risk is across the entire plan. It's not just investment risk. And that's what, you know, here risk, well, yeah. Is how do you reduce the exposure to all risks?
So I'm going to take a risk course for you, right? So to reduce risk.
Very important. And the risk profile questionnaire on February 15th versus March 15th comes out different.
Yeah.
In a 99% of the people.
Yep.
Oh, my God. Right? So we can joke about this. Fees and costs. There are layers and layers of fees and costs inside of plans. Some of them are really worth spending. Some of them are not. You need to understand what the value that you're getting from them. Most strategies increase fees and they compound fees and compound they compound fees and costs. We don't want that to happen. We want to help you save more money. Okay? If we can go in and reduce some lifestyle, cut your taxes, make your debt more efficient, clean up the property and casualty and the insurance and the finance charges that are all over the place. You know, I did a physician's guide to early retirement like 15 years ago now, probably, or 11 years ago, it seems like. You know, we found 9 leaks that just go out of people's plan. It's $100,000.
In the physician's world, that's consistent, right?
Yeah, it was $100,000 a year just leaking out of their plans, right? And these are all known strategies that people don't focus on, right? So if you can go in and find all the leaks and put that money to savings rate without hurting your core lifestyle, the odds of success go up exponentially, right? So save more money, protect that money so that there's more, a bigger moat around the castle, right?
I haven't heard that in a while.
I haven't heard that in a long time. But that
I like that one.
But putting a wall around your assets so that people can't take it. Because like Jim Rohn was talking about the seasons. You know, they're coming after it.
The weeds, the animals, everybody.
Winter, you know, it's coming after your money. You got to protect it, right? I'm kind of getting this inflection as he says it here, okay? So I'm there, I'm protecting it. Now when I hit that retirement mode, I want to make sure I have the maximum amount of retirement, not to age 85, but to 100 plus. Right? Because I don't know how long I'm going to go, but if the plan doesn't work to 100, I don't want to do it. But I want to have the maximum enjoyment. I want to take Sharon and I, when we slow down and retire, we want to have more enjoyment with our family and our grandkids. We want to have that now. We want to have it later. It doesn't change.
Right.
It might become more important, right? And then ultimately pass it to them. Not to people and corporations and other people that, you know, nursing homes. I don't want to pass my wealth to people that don't deserve it.
Right.
You might argue that my kids sometimes don't deserve it because they're, you know, whining bastards. Okay. But the reality is I'd much rather pass it there and for their enjoyment and have wealth through the generations. If you don't have those 7 steps in the plan, and if you really sat down and you said, make a tea list of this, right? Take those 7 steps, outline them. Is my plan increasing my taxes or decreasing my taxes? Is my plan increasing my risk or decreasing my risk? What are the factors that are increasing? And I just went through it. Most plans you would find are actually increasing all of those things, decreasing your retirement income, passing less to your family, and having less protection. Most plans are designed to do that.
Right. Why is that?
Because the financial institutions and the government want our money. Big Brother is coming after us.
Right.
I don't want to be that crazy, but we are. So, so what I want, here's the purpose of the conversation, right? We want you to know that this wealth curve conversation is something that has been going on with many people for a long time. It's the conversation about you, your plan, your wealth, your dreams, your fears, your financial future, the stuff that you got to navigate through. We want to be the people that help you to navigate through this. So on the website, if you go to smallwoodassociates.com, when you come in, there's a blurb that pops up that allows you to click it, and it brings you to the page where you can see the guide to, you know, the nine core principles of navigating financial success. You can download it. You put your email in. It comes in an email. There's podcasts that you can consume. We have the 19 sources of retirement income available for download as well. These things are here as resources. We want you to have a conversation. The conversation has no obligation. You can have a 30-minute conversation with us, and there's no obligation. If you don't find it of value, you don't have to do anything afterwards, right? And the best news is you don't have to come in. You don't have to get together. We do it on the web. We've always done it on the web because that's the way we like it, because we want to get to know you. If you don't like us, you're probably not listening to the podcast though. Okay? But my point is that conversation is going to determine the direction we should be going in. What information do we need to receive? How do we finally build your blueprint and then look at your scorecard? The blueprint is the snapshot of the detail. What really happened last year, or, you know, through the 6-month period, what's going on? Where am I ranking in the plan? And then you can determine, okay, now that I understand this, what are the actions that I need to take today, tomorrow, and next week and next year? And we invite you to do that. Right on our website, you can schedule a free no obligation thing. It sets it up. You pick your time.
It's a conversation just like this. So.
It's pretty easy.
Yep.
It's pretty easy. So thank you for listening. Look forward to seeing you. Also on the website, there's webinars that are every 2 weeks. There's going to be some on-demand seminars coming also in the next couple of weeks that'll be more detailed than what we talk about in some of these pressures that we're working on. So thank you. Have a wonderful day. Drive safe. Enjoy the commute eventually. Have a good day, guys. Thank you. Welcome to the end of the video. Smallwood Wealth Management is an investment advisor representative. The opinions expressed by Smallwood Wealth Management and guests on this show are their own. All statements and opinions expressed are based upon information considered reliable, although it should not be relied upon as such. Any statements or opinions are subject to change without notice. Information presented for this educational purposes only. Moreover, no listener should assume that any discussions or information presented serves as a receipt of or substitute for personalized advice from Smallwood Wealth Management or from any other investment professional, and is not intended as an offer of solicitation for the sale or purchase of any specific securities, investments, or investment strategies. Smallwood Wealth Management is not a law firm or an accounting firm, and no portion of this presentation should be interpreted as legal, accounting, or tax advice. Information expressed does not take into account your specific situation or objectives and is not intended as a recommendation appropriate for any individual. Listeners are encouraged to seek advice from a qualified tax, legal, or investment advisor to determine whether any information presented may be suitable for their specific situation. Thank you for listening.